Just connect with your breath, be with yourself. The breath being the most accessible thing, very easily accessible, always at hand. And it is a friend of our life. Just be attentive to the breath. Be a friend of the breath, go hand in hand with the breath. And of course, your position matters, the way you're sitting, the way your position is, the alignment, which allows the free flow of the breath. Allowing the breath to come in freely, allowing the breath to go out freely. Whatever needs to be inhaled is being inhaled. Whatever needs to be exhaled is being exhaled. Let the things happen on their own. Nature is just with us. Experience the inner space, receiving the breath, the touch of the breath, the flow of the breath, right from your nostrils to the inner space. Sometimes our own restrictions, our own holding on, the attitude of holding on, does not allow the breath to be free. So let the breath be free. Let it take its own sweet time. Let it take its own pace. With this natural flowing energy, naturally flowing prana, just combine the divine sound of Om. And we are going to experience this divinity with the Omkar. When Patanjali says, Tasya Vachaka Pranava, he is referring to that Ishvara. The Ishvara denoted by the Pranava. Pranava is the Omkar. Let this Omkar flow through you when we chant it. It is not restricted to your breath or your respiratory system or your vocal cords. It is flowing through. Breathe in. And let us chant the prayer for the team spirit for which the Prana Yoga Therapy Center is known for. Sahana Bhavatu, Sahana Bhunaktu, Sahavyam Karavavahai, Tejas Vina Adhitamastu, Navidushavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Namaste everyone, and a warm welcome to all of you again on this Sunday afternoon. Thank you for joining. And this shows that how much everyone is wanting to have the knowledge in the knowledge sharing session with Dr. Baljot today, the second episode of this, on which she is talking about the PCOS. And yesterday she had covered a lot of part from the modern science, the aspect of PCOS from the anatomical point of view, physiological point of view, the endocrine system. And to keep into the Ayurveda aspect she had explained. So today we will be going further with her talk. And she's a very generous lady in sharing her knowledge. And Dr. Baljot has been very active in the profession of Ayurveda. She has never left the hand of Ayurveda. She is a professor with Shaheed Kartar Singh Ayurveda College, Ludhiana. She is the professor in Prasuti Tantra and Sweet Oak department. So we would get a lot of insight from in this subject of PCOS, which is very rampant nowadays. And hope to help us, this would knowledge would help all of us, whether we are doctors or yoga teachers, that how the Ayurveda perspective holds true for the PCOS subject, for the PCOS problem, to create a better future in our nation, anywhere in the world, wherever you are from. You can help in your surroundings, whether you're yoga teachers, you're a doctor, or you are a health professional. So this would be giving you a great light into it. So Dr. Baljot has done a lot of research also, and she has always worked in the wellness field for the women. She has helped many people with, suffering from infertility. So Ayurveda has done real miracles, and she's going to share with us. Dr. Baljot, have you joined? Dr. Baljot, are you there?
No, ma'am.
Not yet? No, ma'am. I think some technical difficulties.
Yes.
I just spoke to her and she said she's joining. I will just share with you how my journey was there. When I had started with my practice so many years back, like 25 years back, and that time I was not finding many PCOS cases. I still remember my first case of PCOS in my own practice. And this lady came to me and she was wanting to have a child. And that was the time, the first time I had handled her, and we had helped her with yoga. And I was also studying into this, and then I looked into it more, how I could help this lady with PCOS. And we worked on it. And after maybe 3 or 4 years of regular practice, and she was following, the problem was that she was changing doctors from one doctor to the other. And then we advised her that you please stick to one type of treatment. Don't hop on from here and there. Because when the medicine starts working with you, the pathy, whatever pathy you're following, it starts working on you, and that time, that is the time you are changing your doctor. So that should not happen. So that's, this counseling also has to be done with your client, and this regular yoga practice and all that. So she got a baby after that. And that was my first encounter with PCOS. And later on, of course, I have seen, I wouldn't be anecdotal. I have seen other cases also where nothing worked. So it was something like, primary infertility. So where we could not help anywhere. But yes, the journey was smoother in the psychological aspect than in those few cases where we could not help. But then this was helping them. The yoga part was helping them psychologically, and also helping them even in the, they were in the process of adoption. And this adoption was also very painful sometimes, Like one case I remember, when this lady was into adoption and the process was going on for a long time, and she had to wait for 2 years because she was an NRI and she was they had to make her wait. There was a long queue. Ultimately, she got a lovely daughter. So that is a painful condition, but then the future can be really worse when if you the percentage of PCOS goes higher and higher, like now it is like 15 to 20% of the population, and previously it was just 3%. So it has increased in the last 20 years to a great extent. And it is a painful procedure when the women suffering from PCOS and looking towards fertility. So it is a painful process that happens that way. But with yoga, we have found very good results. Of course, it is a combined plan of lifestyle management, as Dr. Baljot was also referring yesterday, that lifestyle management and yoga and everything together matters. It is not only one thing, which was your counseling part also is very important. So you as a doctor or a health professional or a yoga teacher, you have to be very particular about, you know, counseling and making the client feel at well-being. And the Ayurveda medicines, lifestyle management, food habits, sleep patterns, and relaxation, physical activity, everything is very, very important in this case of PCOS. Just give me 1 minute. I will again just call back.
Ma'am?
Yeah?
Yeah, ma'am, I talk with her. There's some update that the laptop has started. We should do just 5 minutes more. So, yeah.
Oh.
I already had a talk with her.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So we have this process of our Pranayoga Therapy Center is in the process of starting with the new therapy course, yoga therapy course in May. And we have completed the first batch of yoga therapy course according to the YCV standards. And the exams are about to happen in the last week of April. And we have got a wonderful team. We are also running the TTC teachers training course, again, according to the YCV standards, level 1, level 2, level 3. And this yoga therapy course for the yoga therapists and for doctors, therapy yoga consultants. So this is our activity. Morning and evening, we have yoga classes, fitness classes. Morning class is a Shivananda class, wherein we have experienced and senior Shivananda faculties who have helped us in the morning to conduct these classes, 7 o'clock in the morning to 8:30. We have these classes. Evening, we have a special class for ladies who are veteran doctors. Veteran people are there in the evening, the senior ladies. And that's a wonderful batch which is running since last 30 years. Now it is all online. This is there. They have come up with a new yoga project for the visually impaired people. So wherein our whole team is working on it, and they are giving online one-on-one yoga lessons to the people who are blind. And it is running really successful, because we have got a very good feedback from the visually impaired community that there was never a teacher who could teach them good asanas, who could make them do Surya Namaskar. And our teachers have been very successful in doing that to online, wherein we cannot go and touch and correct the person. The person cannot see us. That is the condition. And our teachers have really done a great job. I would take this opportunity to appreciate my whole team, wherein we have got these 30 teachers who are working with us, and they have supported us in the project for the blind yoga. And I'm really proud of them. I just wanted to thank all of them in front of you all, that they, because of their support, we were successful in this project, and the project is still running on. And we would always be happy to welcome new yoga teachers other than the Pran Yoga team who want to participate in this project. And in future, we would come up with more such projects wherein we will include every segment of people from the society. So no sector in the society would be left untouched by yoga. So I would welcome anyone who wants to work with us in this project, wherein we would work and study the various disabilities and work on it through yoga. And there was a question in the chat box that some asanas for the PCOS. So I would appreciate if you listen to Dr. Baljot's lecture first, and then we could talk about this, because the concept with which you will give the asana, that should be very clear in your mind. The concept, because the concept is borrowed from Ayurveda. Ayurveda and yoga being parallel sciences of the same timeline, and they were written about the same time, so many thousands of years back. The terminology, the language which was used in yoga texts and in the Ayurveda texts is very same, I would say. I wouldn't say similar also, but it's same. The terms, the body physiology and everything, the explanation is mentioned in these Sanskrit texts, wherein we see in the different Sanhitas of Ayurveda and the yoga texts like Hatha Yoga Pradipika and the Girinda Samhita. So they have this similar terminology. Like, for example, I will tell you, Ayurveda follows this philosophy, physiology of dosha, the three doshas, Vata, Pitta, and Kapha. Okay. So similar, these terminologies are used in the Hatha Yoga Pradipika and the texts of yoga. So Shleshma, the Medha, the Dhatus, everything, all the words have been used in the same way. The pattern of describing the problem is also the same in Ayurveda and yoga. So we can really call them as sister sciences, and we can connect with Ayurveda and yoga. So if we know some part of Ayurveda, and when we understand the physiology, what is happening in a particular disease, and then if we read a yoga text, then we will be very well able to understand how it would work and how yoga practice can be applied to the concept of Ayurveda. Like example, like Dr. Baljot was talking about the Agni concept yesterday. And when you want to improve the Agni, so maybe it is Jatar Agni or the Dhatu Agni. So of course, Ayurveda has got some medicines about it. But then whatever activities can increase your Agni, like in yoga asanas, your yoga practices also, pranayams, there are different practices in yoga which would improve your Agni, improve your Jatar Agni, improve your Dhatu Agni. So we have to find out where in the text this is mentioned about the Agni part. And that's how we are correlating the Ayurveda concept with the yoga concept. And there we found very good results. So in PCOS also, when you want to improve the Agni, you have to give those practices which will improve the Agni. So can you think of anything which is improving the Agni? Which activity? Just for namesake. Any activity, not only yoga. Anyone can share. ऐसा कौन सा एक्टिविटी है जिसको करने से आपको अच्छी भूख लगती है? It can be any sports, right? It can be anything which is giving you a good workout feeling. Do you agree?
Even fasting would count here, ma'am.
Fasting, we have to be careful, because as mentioned yesterday, it can be combined with diabetes. So if you are talking about PCOS, if the diabetes is also there, then we have to be very careful, because fasting might make the person hypoglycemic, and then it would create a havoc.
Right.
Yeah. So we have to be very careful when we do the fasting mechanism. So if you are, of course, fasting has its own benefits, but then we have to be particular about the fasting. So if we are giving that normal food to the body, or we are giving a lighter food wherein the body has to spend less energy. Yeah. So less energy to digest the food. Then you can keep the Agni intact. I'll give you the example of the Havan Kunda, that how you keep the fire lighted and you keep on putting some small ahutis into the Havan Kunda. The fire is burning, you know, that auspicious Yajna fire. So when you put a lot of ahuti over it, or whatever you have, the ahuti or the fuel for the fire, if you pour it all together at once on the fire would die down. Or if you do not supply fuel to the fire for a long time, the fire will use its own fuel, whatever was there in the pan, and then it would die down. So both ways, it is not working. So either you have to give small amounts of fuel to keep it burning and at proper regular intervals, right? Same thing applies to your Jathar Agni in the body. Jathar is the abdomen. So the fire which is in the abdomen, that is in your stomach. Jisko hum aam bhasha mein bhook kehte hain, hunger. So many times there is a word called appetite and there is a hunger. Do you can you understand the difference between appetite and hunger? No? Can you guess, any guesses? Come up, anyone?
Ma'am, I think all are in the after lunch effect still.
Tamas. Tamas is dominating.
Appetite is, I think, desire to eat food, ma'am. And what hunger is hunger is simply biological response of body that it wants to have food, I think.
Yeah. So when the body is demanding food, the body is giving you signal, yes, I'm hungry. So that is your hunger.
Yes.
Appetite is, you know, you see something really nice and you start salivating and the appetite is there.
Okay.
So there are these things, appetizers, something like called appetizers. You have seen that on the menu, right?
We have seen that. That is why they are called appetizer, na?
Okay, so when are we eating? You know, are we eating when the body is demanding?
I don't think nowadays they are following this. Yes.
So that is where we have to, you know, this all will be included in a PCOS client. When you are facing a PCOS client, you will have to look into all this. I mean, you have to counsel, you have to talk to that person more and more. It wouldn't be only a one-sided conversation. Many times you will have to be a very good listener also for your client. That stress accumulates, their bottled up emotions are there. So you will have to let them out. So many times as yoga teachers will have to be also, or as doctors or anybody who's helping for a person, you will have to be a very good listener to your client. Many times I do see this, that doctors do not have time to listen to the client. They don't even have time to look into the eyes of the client, of the patient. So that thing should be, you know, you should have a little, maybe you have 2 minutes at least, just look at the client and talk to them. And of course, with yoga practice, when you are teaching yoga, you have a good time. I mean, you keep a good time to teach, and that is the time you can be very communicative with your client. So that helps a lot. Like your PCOS, again, it is very, it fat is involved. Like you have lean PCOS cases also, but many times, more frequent is the obese PCOS, wherein the client is obese, overweight. So then what happens? You have to work on the Medh Dhatu. The fat. So again, the Dhatu Agni is weak And that is why the further dhatus are getting, not forming, but more accumulation of medha is happening. You have to increase the agni. So again, your medha is fat. In Ayurveda, it is medha. So all the dhatu agnis have to be worked upon. So of course, Ayurveda will have a proper light on it to about the medicine part. But in yoga, what practices do you have? Somebody was asking, could you suggest some practices or asanas in these years? So you think now, I am giving you pointers. Can you think of those asanas which will correct the agnis? I mean, do you remember your text that which of the asanas are good for agni, pradipti?
Vajrasana.
Abdominal twisting asana.
Paschimottanasana, ma'am.
Yeah. Good replies are coming. So you all remember the Hatha Yoga Pradipika text.
Pavan Muktasana.
Padhastasana.
Sarvangasana.
And what else?
Sarvangasana.
Okay. Yeah, when there is a thyroid malfunction, then you can introduce Sarvangasana as well.
Ma'am, Surya Namaskar.
Yes.
Ghamni Pranayama, ma'am.
Pranayama is, ma'am, Agnisar. Best.
Agnisar, yes. Agnisar. And Agnisar works at a very micro level, I tell you.
Yes.
Because not only Jathar Agni, but also your Dhatu Agni is worked upon.
Whole abdomen.
Don't restrict it to a part. Don't restrict it to one part of the body, like only abdomen. So Agnisar can work at the micro level. It can work on your hormones. It can work on your BMR. It can work on the Dhatu Agnis. So each Dhatu has its own Agni. Each Dhatu is formed after the previous Dhatu. So it's a sequential form. Like yesterday also she had mentioned about the Dhatu's sequence. Rasa, Rakta, Mansa, Medha, Asti, Majja and Shukra. So after the Rasa Dhatu, the Rakta is formed. Rakta, after the Rakta, the Mansa is formed. So according to that, every Dhatu has its own metabolic power. No? So Dhatus are those tissues which are forming the body. A combination of the tissues is forming the whole body. So your body is made up of skin and muscle and bones and marrow and veins and arteries and your brain, everything, nerves. So all these systems compiled together is the body. So according to Ayurveda, we have all these dhatus are maintaining this body, forming this body. Right? So this dhatu agni is really worked upon with the regular practice of agnisara. So you have to be very particular about how you teach the pranayama. Again, it should not be a forceful method. So take your client gradually from the basic to the moderate and to the intense. You have mentioned about Surya Namaskar. But then how you tell me now, if just imagine a client in front of you with obesity, with PCOS, okay? She's 85, 90 kgs. Now, first time she comes to you, how will you start?
Ma'am, from Uriyan Band. Practice of Uriyan Band can help Agnisar best, to do best.
Yeah, that is it. Uriyan Band, the Uriyan Kriya, both are there. You remember the difference between Uriyan Band and Uriyan Kriya? So you have to just think of those. You know, Kriyas are cleansing practices, which are preparatory practices for pranayama. And they help to improve the pranayamic benefits. Udyan Kriya is there and Udyan Bandha is there, which is applied during the Kumbhaka period of the pranayama, the retention phase of the pranayama. Yeah. So that also helps, but yes, Kapalbhati. All these practices. So all of you have mentioned one by one a very good combination, but you have to be very particular in giving the sequence. You cannot right away give the Dhanurasana on the first day. You cannot right away give the Surya Namaskar on the first day of your class. Okay. So
we'll
now
start with the Sukshma Vayam.
Yes.
Pre-prati moment.
Yeah. Sorry?
Pre-prati moments, Sukshma Vayam.
Joint movements.
Ah, yeah. Joint movements, yes. Yeah. So that way, so we will talk that in more in detail. Now Dr. Baljot has joined. And we will go ahead with Dr. Baljot's class. Dr. Baljot, can you hear me? I think her audio is not yet on.
Hello. Good evening.
Oh, yes, doctor. Good
afternoon. I'm trying to join with from phone.
No issues. No issues. Yeah, you have to be grateful to the Wi-Fi Devta now.
Yeah.
Okay. Relax. No issues. We had a good chat about yoga till then.
Okay. Good.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
So whenever you feel comfortable, Dr. Baljot, you can start with your session.
Okay.
We are all set. Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, I'll be doing for the first time from phone. So just give me.
No worries. It's okay. We can understand.
Yeah, but sometimes it doesn't feel good, like people are waiting.
But it's a blessing in disguise that they
could hear you, like your experience and about yoga.
So we were chatting about this thing and Ayurveda part you have to, we are leaving it to you only.
Right.
I have solved a lot of cases, especially the young girls, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Young girls, irregular periods, and like many of them did not get periods, like dysmenorrhea many times, and like, yeah, Raj Pravartani Vati and all these medicines have really helped. And regular periods, the modern doctors put them on contraceptive pills, and then the side effects are there, they don't want that. I have found very good results with this, with Ayurveda.
Okay, nice.
Handing over back to you.
Yeah, thank you, Shilpa, for sharing your experience.
Thank you.
Spreading Ayurveda all over the world slowly.
It's always nice to hear.
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Baljot, are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Yeah, please take over.
Yeah.
Ma'am, you can switch on your video. Yes, I'll share.
Yeah, I've done that.
No, yeah, this is good.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. I'm really sorry. You have to wait for the session. I think we'll go to the slide where Ayurvedic. Yes, this one. Previous one. Yeah, from the hair. Yeah. Yesterday, we had discussed about the modern aspect of PCOS. So today, we will be discussing about the Ayurvedic aspect. Next slide. So as we had discussed yesterday, what is health? Health is not just the physical aspect, It is also on the physical level, it is our doshas, our dushyas or the tissues, and the malas or the urine, stool, sweat. These all should be healthy, and our mental status, our emotional status, that should also be in balance. So when we are in this state, we are healthy. Next slide, please. So before moving on to PCOS, I will just want to give you just an idea about the dhatus. So first dhatu is called as the ras dhatu, and its main function is preenan, or the nourishing. It nourishes the body. It nourishes body at the cellular level. Then tushti, or the satisfying, or the satiation. So it is the satiety is at on all the levels, and these tissues, they don't work on the physical level only. They work on your mental aspect, on your they represent your emotional aspect also. So tushti means whatever we have, the food we are having, we are satisfied, and we feel healthy, and on the mental level also we are happy and satisfied. Then next is the rakta dhatu. It nourishes that. So, and when ras dhatu is depleted, or it is not in a healthy status, we can feel these symptoms like shram, or we feel fatigue, and then shosh is there. You don't, then emaciation in the there you in the body, you feel weakness. Then glani, or the dizziness. Then this is very specific shabd sahishnuta, that loud voice we are not comfortable with. And especially sometimes in people with cardiovascular problems, they will always say, or when elderly people, they are also having a ras kshaya status. So they will also say, why you are shouting? I mean, like, even if we are talking normally, then also they will find it a bit louder. So these aspects, why I'm trying to explain it, that because when a patient comes to you, she will talk in detail, like what she feels. So we can make out that at what level problem is there. Then rudravata, palpitation. So whatever small work she will do, or whether she climbs stairs, or she walks for a short time, she will feel palpitation. And this happens in the weak patients also, those who are having general weakness. Then there is dyspnea on slight exertion. Next slide, please. Then is rakta dhatu and mansa dhatu. So rakta dhatu, it gives jeevan. It is the supporting life. Blood is the basic support of our life. Then ushmakar, that is it is pitta dharmi rakta. So it maintains the body temperature. It is varnakar. It is responsible for the proper optimum hemoglobin, red blood cells. So it gives you that glow on the face, glow on the skin. And mans pushtikar, because next dhatu is mans, so it nourishes that also. So when there is a depletion in the rakta dhatu, then amla shishir priti, like patient wants to have sour or cold foods. So you can this is the main symptom of patients with anemia, like they want to have ice, they want to have especially in the first trimester of pregnancy, there is a little imbalance of the dhatus. So they want to have sour fruits or sour things. Then sira shaithilya, looseness in blood vessels. So that, like the varicosity, varicose veins, that is one example of that. Then rukshata, dryness of the skin. So whenever this we can see in the females, especially who are having heavy menses. After the menses are over, you can feel that the skin is a bit drier, on the drier side, right? So that we can make out. Then Panduta, that is anemia, symptoms of anemia will be there. Then Parushta, roughness, like skin will be dry, it will be a bit rough. And similarly, these symptoms, when we see the elderly persons in our home also, so we can connect to it and we can understand it better. How the dhatus are giving the symptoms. Then Suptata and Malanta, that is dullness of the skin. Then Mans Dhatu, it has the function of Deha Lepa. It is covering over the body, forming the contour. Like it is kind of a covering. Then Cheshtahar, it is Cheshtakar. It is responsible for all the movements. So though bones or the joints are mainly responsible for the function movement of the body, but this Mans Dhatu, it gives flexibility. Then Medha Pushtikar. So next Dhatu is Medha Dhatu. So it nourishes that also. Then this Mans Dhatu emaciation, it will give Akshaglani, weakness of sense organ or the eyes. Then Ganda, Svikha, Shushkata, that is emaciation of the cheeks, buttocks, weakening of the limbs. So when Mans Dhatu is not healthy, we can see the loss on the kind of inch loss we can feel. Then Griva, Udar, Shushkata, emaciation of the neck and abdomen. Next slide, yeah. Then next is Medha Dhatu. Are you comfortable like the way I'm talking? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going a bit, little bit fast, actually.
Yes, it is clear, ma'am.
So Medha Dhatu, it gives Snigdhata, that is the lubrication to the body. It gives the Dadharya, that is the stability and plumpiness. And Asthi Pushti, because the next Dhatu is Asthi, so it nourishes the Asthi Dhatu or the skeletal system. And the Kshay of Medha Dhatu will give Swapnam Katya or the loss of sensation in lumbar region. Then Kliha Vriddhi, Krishnagata, like body emaciation, right? And Sandhi is Futan, cracking of joints. You feel pain or you will find, the patient will say that when they get up, there is sound joints in the joints. Then Glani or the dizziness, then Akshan, Akshanasaya, the tiredness of eyes. And Udar, Tanmrita, thinness of abdomen. So whenever there is a loss of weight, then Mans Dhatu and Medha Dhatu are the main factors in that. And obesity also, Medha Dhatu and Mans Dhatu. The next is the Asthi Dhatu. It has the function of dharan. It supports the body by providing the erect posture. And Majja Pushtikar. And the next dhatu is Majja. So it nourishes the Majja Dhatu. Then the kshay of Majja Asthi Dhatu will give Asthi Tod. That is pain in the bones, joints. Then Danta. Dant Kesh Nakhadishu, that is the teeth becoming porous, hair fall, nails becoming brittle, hair falling of beard including mustaches. These are all due to loss in Asthi Dhatu. Then Shram, tiredness, and Asthi and Sandhi Shaithilya, that is looseness of the joints. Next slide, please. Then it is Majja Dhatu. Its function is Asthi Puran, because bone marrow is in the hollow part of the bones. So, and Snehan, it causes the lubrication of the whole body. Then it is Balkar, it provides the strength, and then it nourishes the next dharu, that is the Shukra. Then Kshay of Asthi Dhatu will lead to Asthi Saushirya, that is the osteoporosis, Bhram, giddiness, then Timir Darshan, then darkness in the front of the eyes, Dorbalya, Laghu Asthi, thinness, weakness, and the bones become light, or like the osteopenia and osteoporosis, they are all the, they all reflect the status of Asthi Dhatu. And Vata Rog mainly. So it is inversely proportioned. When Vata will increase, Asthi Dhatu will decrease. And when Vata is in balance, Asthi Dhatu is also in balance. So when during this old age is this period where Vata is predominant, and we find the symptoms of osteoporosis are very common. And then last is the Shukra Dhatu, or the Artav in females. Those Shukra has been described as of two types. One is the Sthanik, and one is the Sarva Sharirga. That is, one is the local, that is the sperm factor, and other is the which is in the whole body, that is the hormones, or the sexual steroidogenesis. It reflects steroidogenesis. Then, the functions of Shukra is the Dhairya, Harsh, that is the courage, pleasure, strength, and Garbhotpatti, or the formation of the embryo. It is the organ of Dhatu for procreation. So when there is Kshay in the Shukra Dhatu, there will be Chirat Prasek, or the delayed ejaculation. Then there will be Shonit with the Shukra, the sperm ejaculation with blood, then pain in the reproductive organs, weakness will be there, dryness of mouth, pallor, Pandutva, sudden lassitude, tiredness, impotency, and in females it will lead to menstrual disorders and infertility. So this is in general, I'm giving you an idea how dhatus work, and what is their proper function, and when they are not in a balanced state, what symptoms we can see. So these many symptoms are interrelated, so we have to work on that, like what to diagnose and how to diagnose that disease. Next slide, please. So this we have talked about the functions of the dhatus, and now I'll be talking about the upadhatu and mal of dhatus. So Ras Dhatu is the Upadhatu is Tanya and Rajaha. So breast milk and Rajaha, that is the endometrium, and the we can consider the endometrial cycle and the ovarian cycle. These are the part of the menstrual cycle. So when Ras Dhatu is healthy, it will make a healthy Raja. So it will lead to healthy menstrual cycle and healthy HPO axis, hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis, and the hormones will also function in balance. Rakta Dhatu is Kandara and Sira, the veins and the arteries. These are the Upadhatu. They are formed from Rakta Dhatu. From Mans Dhatu, it is Vasa and Tvak. There is the skin and the fat portion. Then med dhatu is snayu and sandhi. Joints and the ligaments are formed from med dhatu. And then the mal of ras dhatu is kapha. Kaf and pit, they are the three doshas. But when they are not in balanced form, they function as a vitiated kaf. Then pit, then mans dhatu, there we have karna mal, nasika mal, akshi mal, and the asya mal, the salivation and the earwax, right? These are all mans dhatu, mal. Then med dhatu is swed. So we can find, you usually find the obese people, they have, they sweat more. And it is foul smelling also. So, and asthi dhatu is kesh, shamashru, lom, nakh, hair, beard, nails, they are all the mal of asthi dhatu. Then majja dhatu is akshi sneha, vita sneha, tokta sneha. So these malas, mal, when they are in optimum quantity, they provide health to the body. But when they are vitiated, they will produce the symptoms. Next slide, please. So I will just go through med dhatu and majja dhatu mainly because they are important in the metabolism and in the functions of the hormones. Now, adipose tissue and lipids form the medo dhatu. Then, as we had discussed yesterday, that adipocytes and adipose tissue is plays a very significant role in PCOD, and if they are not in the optimum level, they produce inflammation, and that leads to insulin resistance and diabetes also. So leptin in adipose tissue gives signal to hypothalamo-pituitary axis at puberty when appropriate body mass is achieved. So leptin has a permissive role. So what happens is that when menarche starts, it has many factors. And one of the factors is the optimum or adipose tissue. When and we will find that very lean girls, they start the menarche a bit late, and those with the those who are overweight or the fat or the adipose tissue is more, they start menarche earlier. And we are seeing precocious puberty or the girls starting menstruation at the ages of 7 years, 8 years. So it can be one of the factors is more central obesity or the adipose tissue, and less of the physical activity. Then this leptin in the adipose tissue, it has a permissive role. When the level of leptin is optimum, then it gives a trigger to HPO axis and the menses starts. So decreased leptin leads to an ovulation. So when adipose tissue is not healthy, leptin is not being produced optimum, then it will lead to anovulation. And anovulation is a symptom of PCOS also. Next slide. Then majja dhatu. So majja dhatu or the bone marrow, we cannot exactly correlate the two things, one given in Ayurveda and one given in the modern science, but we just to have an understanding, we just try to correlate. Now, rakta dhatu, along with rasta dhatu, reaches all the organs of the body, right? And helps in synthesizing their individual dhatu and finally reaching sarakta medas of majja dhatu. So bone marrow is also of two types, yellow bone marrow and red bone marrow. So ras dhatu along with, because ras blood is circulating in the body, and ras, that is the nutrient aspect or the first dhatu, along with rak dhatu or the blood circulation, it reaches all the organs and helps in synthesizing their individual dhatu and finally reaching the majja dhatu. So it is also referred as the seat of vayu, and it nourishes the shukra. Slide, I cannot see. I cannot see the PPT.
Khushbu, Dr. Khushbu. Hello, Dr. Khushbu, are you there? Yeah, she will join in a moment.
Okay.
She lost the connection. Yeah, she has joined back.
Yes, ma'am. Sorry, lost the network.
Okay. Yeah, it's okay. It's Sunday. Sometimes. Okay. So, Majja Dhatu is referred to as the seat of Vayu and nourishes Shukra. See, Asthi Dhatu is also the seat of Vayu. And since Majja Dhatu is inside the bones, it is also the seat of Vayu and it nourishes the Shukra Dhatu. Now, from infancy to maturity, there is increase in fatty yellow marrow. In adolescence, the red marrow of long bones is converted to yellow marrow, right? So, and this fatty yellow marrow significantly contributes to extragonadal steroidogenesis, which activates the HPO axis at the time of puberty. So, red marrow converts to fatty yellow marrow as children step into puberty, and it helps in the steroidogenesis or the hormonal changes that are occurring in the body. It contributes to that. So Majja Dhatu, indirectly, it is also a type of medas, in turn helps in the synthesis of both Shukra and Arthav Dhatu, which are essential for steroidogenesis and sexual organogenesis. So the time of puberty or adolescence is very significant. So having a healthy lifestyle is very important in this stage also. So that that vata is also in the balance, and it and all the dhatus, they are also functioning in homeostasis. Next slide, please. Then, this we had talked about the doshas or the dhatus, and how doshas are functioning. As we all know that vat, pit, kapha, they also have five subtypes each. So here I will be mainly talking about the vat dosha. So the function of hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis is controlled by pran, udan, and saman vayu equilibrium, right? Pran is in the head region. Udan is mainly, so it has varied body organs, but mainly udan is in the kind of chest area, throat area. Saman is in the abdomen part. But they all function in equilibrium. Then Vyan Vayu, it maintains the normal dhatu gati or the vascularity or the circulation, because Vyan Vayu, it circulates in whole of the body. Apan Vayu is in the pelvic region, and it controls the Artham Nishkraman or expulsion of stools, fetus, urine, and the menstrual blood. These are all the functions of normal Apan Vayu. So, and Pachak Pith helps in maturation, steroidogenesis via saman vayu. So pachak pit is, it helps in the metabolism at all, on all the levels. Next slide, please. So coming to PCOS in Ayurveda, so there is no direct reference of PCOS in Ayurveda, but all the gynecological disorders have been described under Yoni Vyapad, Arthavdushti and Jatharinis. So there are some Yoni Vyapad and some Jatharinis which reflect the symptoms of PCOS. Next slide, please. So the most closely we can understand is the Pushpagni Jatharini. Here it is said, Vritha Pushpam Tu Ya Nari Yatha Kalam Prapashyati Sthul Lom Ganda Va Pushpagni Sa Api Revati. So Vritha Pushpam Tu Ya Nari. So Vritha Pushpam is that Pushp is the follicle or the ovum which has not ruptured. So Vritha Pushpam, that has been wasted. Yatha Kalam Prapashyati, and though it shows on time, but it does not rupture. And the female is thul or the obese, lomash ganda or the hirsutism, and facial hair on the cheeks and the chest area. So, and she is called as the Pushpagni. So these symptoms are related with the PCOS. These are main things, that the anovulation, obesity, and hirsutism. Then artavakshaya. Artavakshaya yatha uchit kale adarshanam alpata va yoni vedana cha. So artavakshaya ke jo indication given are yatha uchit kale adarshanam. So at the proper time, they do not, menses are not occurring at the proper time. Like as we had discussed yesterday, it is from 21 days to 35 days. When they are not occurring on, in between these periods, or they are coming late, that is yatha uchit kale adarshanam alpata, that is amount is less. And va yoni vedana cha, and the pelvic pain is also there. So these symptoms are also there in the PCOS. Next slide, please. Then nasht artav, dosha hai avrit margatvat artavam nashyati striyaha. Sometimes there is avaran of the doshas. They obstruct the srotas, they obstruct the passage of the artav, so that there is absence of menstruation. Then vandhya yoni vyapad, vandhyam nasht artavam vidyat. So where there is artavam, here artavam has a broad spectrum meaning. Artav is said to be menstrual blood flow. It is ovum also. It is hormones also. So when these are not functioning properly and menstrual flow is not there, follicle is not rupturing, anovulation is there, so then that female is called as Vandhya. So all these Yoni Vyapad and the Jatharinis, they reflect the symptoms of PCOD. Next slide, please. So here, this is very interesting. The Acharya Bhav Prakash has said, Raja pravartate yasmat masi masi vishodhayeta sarva sharir doshat cha na pramehayan antyah striyah. So Acharya Bhav Prakash has said that when a female is menstruating regularly, then there are no chances of having prameh in that female. So in these two lines, they have described the whole hormonal aspect, right? So, and we can see in the patients of PCOS that insulin resistance is there, diabetes is also there. So he has indicated that when the female is having regular menses. So now here Rajaha does not mean only the menstrual cycle. It is describing about the hormonal function also. So it is on all the levels that the female is healthy. Her menstrual cycle, her endocrine functions are normal. She is not supposed to affect from prameha. Now here, prameha also is a very wide topic, because prameha also they have described about 20 types. So that also we have to say, prameha does not directly correlate with the diabetes, but still there are other factors also, like insulin resistance is there, blood sugar levels are there. So we have to consider that also. So, but they have given the indication that having healthy menstrual cycle, having healthy menses does not lead to complications. Next slide, please. So what are the nidanas, or what are the causative factors of PCOS? And here they have said, mithya acharen taha strinam pradushte nartavencha jayante bij doshatcha devatcha shrunuta prithak. So here, mithya acharen means asamyak ahar and achar. So it means what diet you are taking and what is your lifestyle. It affects the disease. Then beech dosha titi, that is beech means here the ovum, or the artavgat beej dushti. And here they have specifically mentioned the beej dushti, and here in the further slides also, and I think yesterday also we have discussed that studies have shown that PCOD has a genetic factor also, and the antenatal care, it how the mother has what was her daily routine and what kind of food she has taken, it affects the ovum in the girl child. And we'll see in the further slides that it has start this follicles, they start appearing in the fetal life only. So when mother is not taking care of it, it is affecting the ovarian aspect of the child. Next slide. So the pathophysiology, I'm just giving a general aspect of it. So what happens is, when we are taking kapha prakopa kahar vihar, where with the kapha or the mal kapha is increasing, it will lead to dusht ras dhatu, because whatever we are ingesting, it leads to the formation of ras dhatu, and it will lead to the healthy ras dhatu. But if we are not following the proper lifestyle, it will vitiate the ras dhatu. Then ras dhatu, since artav is the upadhatu of rakt dhatu, so ras dhatu will vitiate the artav dhatu also, and then it will lead to impaired medh dhatu and majja dhatu, and will lead to obstruction in medhovah srotas also. So since the next dhatu is the shukra dhatu, it will vitiate the shukra dhatu, and then it will hamper the ovarian follicle maturation and rupture. So it's just not the ovarian aspect, but since there is impaired medh dhatu and majja dhatu, it will affect the insulin take up also, and it affect the diabetes also. Next slide, please. So what Ayurveda can do, or what lifestyle we should follow to that avoid PCOS, or if we are having PCOS, so how we can manage that. So it has two aspects, swasthyasya swastha rakshanam aturasya vikar prashamnam cha, that is the person who is healthy, they have to maintain the health of that person, and if disease has occurred, we have to cure that. So preventive aspect and the curative aspect. Preventive aspect is swasthvrit, or the lifestyle, And curative is Sanchaman Chikitsa and Shodhan Chikitsa. Sanchaman Chikitsa is the oral medicines and we give. And Shodhan Chikitsa includes Panchkarma. Next slide, please. So regarding the preventive aspect, to lead a quality and healthy life, Ayurveda has advocated Rasayan. So Rasayanas are the vitalizers that bring about proper uptake, growth and improvement and replenishment of the vital tissues. So Rasayan also works on the healthy body only, right? So Rasayanas can be broadly classified as three types: Achar Rasayan, Ahar Rasayan, and Dravya Rasayan. Achar Rasayan is your conduct, right? How you behave, how you think. Then Ahar Rasayan is your food, and Dravya Rasayan is the medicine aspect. So Achar Rasayan, it is mainly related to lifestyle management. And it has its two important pillars are Sadvrit and Swasthvrit. Sadvrit is the good conduct and Swasthvrit is healthy living. So Sadvrit, and it has been proved that good moral life with hygienic living improves the quality of life. So your emotional health, your mental health is related to your physical health. It's just not that you just take care of your taking care of your body and all the time you are in stress or always in low mood and you are not happy with the other people, that also affects your health. So it's in totality that you have to be healthy and hygienic also, because that will avoid the diseases. Next slide, please. So Swasthvrit, now under lifestyle, these things should be followed. Vyayam or the regular exercise, nidra, sleep, manasik abhitap or the psychological factors should be taken care of, abhyang, massage, nasya or the nasal instillation of oil or ghee, then kaval or gandush or the oil pulling, then rajaswala paricharya, that is regimen to be followed during menstrual cycle, then garbhini paricharya or the antenatal care, vegadharan or the urges we should not hold, and Ritucharya, seasonal regimen. Next slide, please. Now, first we'll talk about Nidra, why sleep is so important. Now, sleep allows antioxidants to recover and heal the metabolic injuries. So, see, body is always in a metabolic stress because it is functioning all the time. Catabolism is going on, anabolism is going on. So there is always some inflammatory changes in the very minute levels are going on in the body. When we don't take care of it, that inflammatory reactions lead to the diseases. So antioxidants are working properly during the sleep. And during sleep, melatonin is released from pineal gland. It acts as a free radical scavenger due to its hydrophilic and lipophilic properties. So it can reach every organ and the cells of the body. Since it is hydrophilic also and it is lipophilic also, it can work on the water component also, and it works on the fat component also. Melatonin is seen in follicular fluid before ovulation and can act as antioxidant in ovarian follicular fluid. So this melatonin is very important. So when we sleep properly, it helps in the proper maturation and rupture of the follicle also. And it acts as an antioxidant in ovarian follicular fluid. And nowadays we see premature ovarian failure also, and there is autoimmunity in the ovaries. So the follicles, they don't mature properly and they don't rupture properly. So we have to take care of that also. It also inhibits the excess release of estrogen from reproductive tract. So estrogen is just not a hormone, or it is circulating in the blood. It is in the various organs also. Like it is, it acts on the breasts also, on brain, bone, uterus, ovary. So in some, there is two types of estrogen receptors. So it works positively on the brain and the bone. When there is good, healthy estrogen and good amount of estrogen, it maintains the health of the brain and mainly brain and bone. And when it is in excess, when we see the breast cancers or the endometrial cancer or the ovarian cancers, so excess of estrogen leads to that. So when we are sleeping properly, we are maintaining the estrogen levels also. Next. Yeah, then Mansik Abhitap or the psychological factors. So they when we are in stress, it affects hypothalamus, which leads to corticotropin releasing factor and inhibits release of gonadotropin releasing hormone, leading to hypothalamic amenorrhea or disturbed menstrual cycle. So your stress levels will affect the hypothalamopituitary ovarian axis. And we have seen when there are changes in sometimes life situations are like that the stress factor is there or emotional disturbance is there, patient will complain that menstrual disturbances are there. Next slide, please. So nausea, it is also of two types. One is that we take in the daily routine, and one is has a therapeutic effect. So the daily we take is called as the pratimarsha nasya. That is only one or two drops, like our elders used to apply oil in the nostrils. So when we instill oil in nostrils, what happens is that through nasal mucosa, it directly enters into the systemic blood circulation without first pass into hepatic and intestinal metabolism. And then vascular path transportation through the pooling at the nasal venous blood into the facial vein. The facial vein has no walls, so it communicates freely with the intracranial circulation. So it is said in Ayurveda that nasohi shirso dwara. So here it is, when we apply oil in the nose, it crosses the blood-brain barrier easily. And second thing is that it causes the tarpan also. So when we instill oil in the nose, it helps in the eyes. And since brain is also majja dhatu and eyes are also part of majja dhatu, so it helps in the health of the eyes also. So nowadays we are seeing that small children or children of any age, like they are watching more phone or TV, and the stress is there. And that, due to that also, and the electromagnetic waves also, they cause dryness in the eyes or they cause dryness in the majja dhatu. So when we are applying regularly oil in the nostrils, it is helping the majja dhatu also. Next slide, please. So this is very important, Rajaswala Paricharya or the menstrual cycle regimen. See, nowadays, it's just like menstrual period does not make any difference. You should live your normal life. But what Acharyas have said, and what I also say to all people, that during menses, at least don't be hyperactive. Okay, so see, routine work you have to do, working females, they have to go to the office, but at least the rest you can take, as much you can take, the kind of food you can take, you can just calm yourself mentally. That will help in the healthy the menstrual cycle and your health also. So here they have said that tatha pushpa darshanam darshane prathamam divasat prabhriti brahmacharini snanadya alankar rahit darbh sansarshayini Tri Ratrim Asit. So they have said that menstrual cycle for the first 3 days, there is a proper blood flow. So they have said that when the push shows or when the bleeding starts, then from first day only, you have to live a normal life. You don't have to take bath, or you don't have to get ready. So like any kind of things which excite you should not be done. And you should sleep on darb ka banawa jo hota hai asan. You have to sleep on that. Durva, we say, on that you have to sleep. Because there are two, three things that this durva is has an alkaline effect, and it is styptic also. So it helps in the control of the bleeding, maybe due to prabhav. And then it is said that parna sharav kartal anyatame cha yavakam payasa siddham alpam karshanartham ashniyat tikshna ushna amla lavanani varjayet. And they have said that you take food in patal or the utensils made of mud, and then you have to take payasa with that is the jaw. You have to cook in the milk, or you can take the jaw roti. Then tikshna ushna, whatever is very pungent, spicy, with excess salt, yeah, that should be avoided. So this yavakam payasa, they has been described as chareyam yavakam stokam post shodhanam karshanam. So they have said that the barley we take, it will kosht sanshodhan karshanam. It will clean the kosht or clean the pelvic region, and it works at the cellular level. And kartal sharaf pan anyatam bhojini ha vishyam. So here they have used the word ha vishya. So ha vishya is barley with ghee, or it has two meanings, ha vishya. And the second is that it has to be taken in the small quantities, and the kind we put ahuti in the yagya during havan, we put small amounts. That way we have to take this small amount of cooked barley at regular intervals during for the 3 days of menstrual cycle. So havishyam is saghrit shalyodhanadi shira sanskritam yavannam iti eke. So they have described that havishya is shalyodhan, or we can cook it like a khichdi, or we can boil it in the milk like kheer. That has to be taken. And karshan helps to maintain vaishadya of artha and timely cessation of the menses. So the karshan here, it acts on the menstrual, on the at the local level, on the endometrium. So it cleans the artha dhatu. Next slide, please. So Raja Kal is natural Shodhan Kal leading to Agni Mandya. So like because we are shedding during menstrual cycle, so there is Agni Mandya at the local level. So aim of Rajasalva Paricharya is to avoid vitiation of Vat and Kapha, prevent formation of Ama, and restore energy. So Rajasalva Paricharya is the main objective is to pacify the Vat and Kapha. So to have the optimum follicles, the cuff is required, healthy cuff is required, right? So we need that kind of sneha at the ovarian level, at the follicular level. And we have to maintain the vat also, because if that increases, it will cause the rukshanta at that level. and it will affect the function of the follicles, and it will prevent the formation of arm, because that is the Shodhan Kal is there. Digestive metabolism is slow during that time, and it will restore the energy. So, why we should not do heavy physical activities during menstruation? So you just see the changes happening in the uterus during menstruation. Now, regeneration of endometrium starts even before the menstruation ceases and is completed 2 to 3 days after the end of menstruation. So once menstrual lining has started shedding, at one part time it is shedding, and simultaneously new blood vessels start forming, right? So new blood vessels grow from the stumps of the old one. The glands and the stromal cells are regenerated from the remnants left in the basal zone, right? So it is growing from the shedded blood vessels. Now, regeneration of functional layer is attributed to a unique stem cell population and progenitor cells confined to basalis layer. So as we know that there are three layers in the uterus, and especially the endometrium, it has three layers, and it regenerates from the basal zone. So when they are regenerating, when the new blood vessels are forming, there is unique stem cell population and progenitor cells in the basalis layer. So when there are stem cells, they have the capacity to reproduce or to regenerate any organ. So when we are not taking care of vayu during menstrual cycle, they are going to disturb the stem cell and the progenitor cells also. So then that is why we are seeing a rise in endometriosis, adenomyosis, and all kinds of infertility factors. Next slide, please. So as we talked in the last slide, it was about the endometrial cycle. Simultaneously, in the ovarian cycle, there is recruitment of group of follicles. Now, what happens is that during the cycle, around 10 to 20 follicles, they start maturing, and among them only one will become mature and will rupture. So here what is happening is recruitment of group of follicles, then there is selection of dominant follicle and its maturation, ovulation, then corpus luteum formation and demise of corpus luteum. Now if you can see in this picture, there is cohort of growing follicles just at the first 3 days of the menses, right? And by the fifth day, one follicle will become dominant, and then this one follicle will mature and will rupture, and rest will become atretic and they will be dead. So this first 3 days are very significant. Now these are the they are having the genetic material inside. Ovum is having the genetic material inside it. And during the first 3 days, when we are not taking care of ourselves, we are hampering, we are disturbing the genetic activity in the follicles. So there is accelerated growth of all components of the follicles in the preantral phase. There is production of follicular fluid, which is primarily an ultrafiltrate of blood from vessels within theca interna. So see here, what they are saying is that during first 3 days, follicles are also growing, and the follicular fluid is very important. It has very significant role because it has the ultrafiltrate, that is it has a nutrient aspect, right? From the of blood from vessels within theca interna. So that is what you call the ojas, that is follicular fluid is having. And when we are not taking care of ourselves, we are disturbing that. So that is why an ovulation or hemorrhagic cyst or PCOD, they are becoming very common. Next slide, please. Then Garbhini Paricharya or the antenatal care. Why this is so significant? Because studies have shown that, as I've talked earlier, that PCOD has a genetic cause, and when mothers, they don't take optimum care of themselves, proper food during the pregnancy, it affects the health of the fetus. So what is happening during first trimester, stress is laid on stabilizing the pregnancy and nurturing the uterine bed through Ras and Rakta Dhatu, right? So pregnancy is also a period of oxidative stress, kind of inflammatory changes are there. So during first trimester, the embryo has to take nutrition from the endometrium. And when that is not healthy, embryo will not survive. And that is why we are seeing the rise in first trimester abortions or the spontaneous abortions or the threatened abortions. It is on rise. And it is just that, like, we have to maintain that pregnancy, and just when pregnancy is confirmed, immediately progesterones are started so that that the embryo can survive. So we, like, see, initially we are giving push from the start only. Like, we are not embryo or the environment that embryo needs is not healthy. So how that is going to survive on itself? So we are giving the external push, so like that you have to survive. So the Ras and Rakta Dhatu, they are going to nurture the endometrial uterine bed or the endometrium. So Ras Dhatu should be healthy and Rakta Dhatu should be healthy so that it can reach in a healthy form in the endometrium. The embryo gets nourishment from mother, hence more liquids and fluids are advocated. Morphologically, the endometrial glands are best developed and most active during early human pregnancy. And it has been found that endometrial glands or endometrium, it has micronutrients, all kind of micronutrients, even some amount of gold is also there. So you can just imagine how our body is self-sufficient, that we have to provide the best thing to our body. The glands gradually regress over the first trimester, but still communicate with the intervillous space at least until at least 10 weeks. So first 3 months, embryo is taking nutrition from the endometrium, and after that the placenta develops, and then the fetomaternal circulation starts. So hence they could provide an important source of nutrients, growth factors and cytokines for the fetoplacental unit. And that is why also this first trimester is very significant. When this placenta is developing, and that is there are blood vessels are developing, and there are two waves. It develops in two waves. The one is in the first trimester, and the second one is in the second trimester. And when second trimester, they do not penetrate properly, the blood vessels do not penetrate properly into the uterus, then hypertension or the and eclampsia occurs. So the endometrium may therefore play a greater role in regulating the placental growth and differentiation post-implantation than previously appreciated. So endometrium should be healthy to survive the pregnancy. Next slide, please. So normally in pregnancy, energy requirements increase, leading to release of large amounts of free fatty acids into the liver. So that, as I told already, that it's under oxidative stress. So this requires large reserve of for natural antioxidants in placental mitochondria as well as in liver to prevent lipid peroxidation. So therefore, pregnancy is a state of oxidative stress. When this oxidative stress exceeds, previous slide, please. So it leads to complication in pregnancy. So that is why the Garbhini Paricharya, it is very specific. And Acharyas have described the Garbhini Paricharya month-wise. So in first trimester, we have to give the maximum liquid diet, and ghee is also given. So like that, it has a proper antenatal protocol that we follow and we give to the pregnant ladies. And why this is very significant also, because postnatal depression, or everybody knows, but antenatal depression has also started. So patient in the second trimester, she will show the signs of depression or anxiety. So whenever a pregnant patient is coming to you, you have to rule out that also, right? So if antenatal depression is there, postnatal depression is usually found in most of the mothers. Next slide, please. So here we will be talking about that the Arthav or the follicles, they are formed at the 20th week of the pregnancy. So Arthavam cha yadyapi dvadash varsha turdhavam vanjyate tatha api Arthav utpatti garbhakale eva bhavati. So though Arthav or the menstrual cycle starts at the age of 12 years, but that appears in the intrauterine life. So Arthav, which is explicit at 12 years, is formed in the embryonic life. So the number of oogonia reaches its maximum at 20th week, numbering about 7 million. The estimated number at birth is about 2 million. You know, so this number of follicles, they keep on reducing. They start with the number is about 7 million, but at the 20th week of pregnancy, that is the fifth month. And then when at the time of birth, they reduce to 12 million. And during the first few years of the life, they further decrease. So, and in terms of hormone production, the hypothalamo-pituitary-ovarian axis is active and functional from approximately 20 weeks of fetal life. So 20 weeks, at 20 weeks, follicles are also have started appearing, and the hypothalamo-pituitary-ovarian axis has also started functioning. So when we are not taking care during pregnancy, when we are not taking appropriate nutrients, it is going to affect the health of the female child. And that is why maybe this is one of the cause reasons that we are seeing premature ovarian failure even in the girls of 20 years, 25 years. Yeah, next slide, please. So there is this is very significant. There is the fetal origin of adult disease. Dr. David Barker first popularized the concept of fetal origins of adult disease. Now, what is fetal origin of adult disease? The hypothesis holds that events during early development have a profound impact on one's risk for development of future adult disease. So now low birth weight is a surrogate marker for poor fetal growth, and nutrition is linked to a host of chronic diseases ranging from coronary artery disease, hypertension, obesity, insulin resistance, cancer, and various psychiatric illnesses. So he has found, and in the studies in the rats also, it has shown that when mother is in the stress and psychologically also, and on the physical level also, and she is not taking the proper diet, it affects the health of the baby, which leads to metabolic diseases in the middle life. So that way we have to take care from the pregnancy itself. Next slide, please. So here I will just talk in short about the diet that everybody knows, what to eat and what not to eat. But the fads I will talk mainly. We don't want to have milk, so we can have almond milk, rice milk. See, there is no need to take that. You just think of it that when we take almonds, we are taking 4 or 5, right? And when we are making milk, how many almonds we are taking? And our gut or our digestive system, is it that strong that it can digest that amount of calories or that kind of dense food, right? So half of the problems are from the incorrect food combinations we are taking, right? So one thing is you just see what your elders, what your grandparents, the food they were eating, and they were healthier than us. So that is the reference point. So that what we should eat and what we should not eat. Then one more thing I will like to add, that there are so many tips for weight loss and all those things, that you take the jeera, you take fennel seeds, and you take fenugreek seeds. You take them, but take them in moderation and take it for a small period of time, and then stop, and then again you can continue, but don't take it continuously, because they are nutrient dense foods. Even spices are also, they are in the aushad form, they are not ahar. So that is, if you see that during cooking also, the vegetable portion is more, and only 1 spoon of turmeric we are putting it, right? So it needs to be taken in that quantity only. Yeah, when we are having any problems, you can take it in pinches, in very small doses, to maintain your health. And have variety of food. We don't need to have exotic foods, because our own foods are really nutrient rich. We have to go back to our roots. We have to see, it's just the demand and supply situation. When we are not demanding, production is not there. When we are finding the easy ways, and we are having the packaged foods, it is affecting our health only. So we say that gluten intolerance is there, celiac disease is there. Okay, fine. You can be weak physically, like, or your metabolism can be weak. But when we, and if seen patients, when we treat them, or there is very common complaint is there, we are allergic. It's just not that food is causing allergy. It's just that we are not at the optimum health, so that we can digest it, we can metabolize all those food items, right? So we have to take care of that and just have a variety of foods, take in small quantities and have variety. And especially in the oils, I will suggest that you take your regional oil. Like in some areas, mustard oil is used. In some areas, coconut oil is used. And like in South, is coconut use oil is used. And then this groundnut oil is used. So just have a variety of everything. And one more thing, ghee should be taken. Okay, this does not cause cholesterol or lipid dyslipidemia. Rather, it will help in resolving dyslipidemias. and all other things. So in and then exercise is very important. It should be physical activity of any sort. That can also be you can have variety. Like one day you can have do yogasana, one day you can go for walk, one day you can do aerobics. So that way, whatever suits you or whatever you are comfortable doing, do that. And take guidance and take help. It will make you better. And then massage is also very important. So nowadays, we are seeing deficiency of vitamin D, So most of the time we are not doing the massage. Our grandparents, they used to do massage and sit in the sun. We don't go out in the sun. So all these factors, all these lifestyle changes are making our health worse, right? So in the end, I will say in treating PCOD, we should consider the patient's presentation and extent of pathogenesis. As we have discussed yesterday also, that although sometimes clinically patient may be showing PCOD, but biochemically or then when you do investigations, it is not up to that extent. Or sometimes in investigations, PCOS is indicating, but clinically the patient is not having that much symptoms. So we have to take care of that. So with healthy lifestyle, PCOS can be managed effectively. And to achieve a healthy reproductive life, women should follow a systematic Ayurvedic lifestyle and preventive treatments. And I've seen in some patients also that, especially those who are overweight, when they are doing vigorous exercise in the sense when they are physically very active, their menstrual cycles are regular. And when they stop or when they decrease the intensity of the physical activity, then again menstrual irregularities start. So this is just an example that you have to the patients give varied symptoms, and accordingly we have to counsel them and treat them. Next slide, please. Thank you. And we should be fertile and kind of busy like flowers, that we should spread happiness around us, and we should be happy ourselves also. I think there are many questions.
Yes, ma'am. So I'll take the chat box questions one by one, and then we can address if there are any other questions.
Yeah.
Amazing session, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
There is one question from Pratidna Mayekar. So according to the dhatus, we have to take food intake, or they have the separate food intake for every dhatu. Please clear the concept. And no, actually, no. Nitika ji had also answered her. I'll read that also, ma'am. Then you can add.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, shall I read?
Yes.
Hello. Yeah. So she had written, Nitika ji had written, no, we don't have to take different food. We have to take a balanced diet, and all dhatus will be nourished turn by turn.
Yes.
Because first dhatu will nourish the next dhatu and so on like this.
Right.
Previous dhatu will nourish the next.
Yes. And when there is some problem, when we find out like dhatu wise, then we can supplement that, but otherwise we have to take a balanced diet. It will take care of all the dhatus.
Yeah.
And one more question is, ma'am, which oil is used for eyes in Nasya?
See, when we are doing for the preventive aspect, there is a daily routine. Hello?
Yes, you're audible.
Yeah, then yes, you can apply mustard oil or the sesame oil. It's okay. These two things are fine. Sometimes ghee can also be applied. See, even in Nasya also, you can alter them. Some few days you have taken the mustard oil. See, you just have to apply one or two drops, not more than that. Like where, like our mother used to apply on the finger and apply in the nose. That kind of thing you have to do on the daily basis.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. There's two more questions, Ashiti. Yeah. From Sarika Singh, what medicines can be given in depression in pregnancy, ma'am?
I will not tell about the medicines on this platform, rather to consult your doctor. But you can have like ghee, then you can have you need to have proper amount of sneha in the diet, so that will nourish your brain also, that will nourish your depression is due to due to the roughness in the body or dryness in the body. So we have to supplement that. So you should take homemade butter. You can make it daily. Like you need to take one or two spoons only, right? And then do meditation and add a variety of food in your this. You can have pomegranate. You can have munakka or the grapes you can have, and then ghee, milk, take all these things. And we have a proper regimen, we have proper protocol, we have proper medicines according to month-wise development during pregnancy. So you can consult any Ayurvedic doctor, that will help.
Let me just add something. So yeah. Anyone who wants to consult Dr. Baljot, we will display her number on the screen. And you can copy that, and you can talk to her for personal problems. You can talk to her later, or maybe you can just talk to her and you can arrange for a consultation. Dr. Baljot, he does video calling as well. So medicine part is very complicated in Ayurveda, because we have to see the prakruti and the condition of the person, everything, and then only the medicines are dispensed. Yeah, please do not ask personal questions. We will give you Dr. Baljot's number if you want to consult her.
Yeah, anytime.
yeah.
Ma'am, there is
because one medicine doesn't apply for everyone, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Even in Garbhini Paricharya, though, they have given the medicines, they have given the protocol, but that also varies from patient to patient.
Right. Next question, we can go.
Yes, ma'am. So the next question is, my daughter is 21, having PCOS. She has extreme period cramps. Her blood flow stops on third day and restarts on the fourth day.
Right.
And the cramps also aggravate again. What can I help her with an Ayurvedic perspective?
First of all, just check her lifestyle, her diet, her sleep pattern, her water intake, and is she having salads, fruits, ghee in her diet? Just check that, and amount of physical activity, how much she is doing it. These things will help in her periods. One thing you can do, like when her menses starts, like 2-3 days before, you can give her. This is just for you and rest. If you have to take that, just consult your physician, please. Yeah, you can give her the quart of dhania. You do one thing: you take one spoon of that sabut dhania or the coriander seeds, crush them, and boil them in 4 glasses of water. Make it boil it till one glass remains. And just that she has to drink 2 to 3 sips, and she has to finish it in the whole day. So just try to do that, and just check for the stools. The constipation is not there. These things will help her a lot. And before menses, like 4 or 5 days before menses, just tell her to take very light and healthy diet. She can take khichdi, mungdal and khichdi once a time, 4 or 5 days before menses. That will help.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I hope, yes, so Rinkuji has got her answer. Anyone has any other questions, then you can unmute and ask. So I think, ma'am, we have addressed all the questions here.
So this this problem, no, what she is referring to, the last question, this also question is taken care of with yoga. It helps a lot, you know, when because there is a blockage of the apanavayu. Intermittently, the blockage releases. Intermittently, it blocks. So, you know, when you do yoga postures and you're doing it for the whole month, and when the menses start, then it is a smoother flow.
Yes,
that's what we have observed.
Yes,
and even during menstruation, we have special asanas which can be done to ease the flow. To remove the blockage of the apanavayu. Yeah. So that way, you know, we can help the clients during menstruation for these type of problems as well. Right. I mean, in the PCOS workshop, whatever is going on now, we are running with the PCOS workshop and the pre and postnatal yoga workshop as well, in which we are talking of many things like this. And Dr. Baljot, you have added a very good aspect to it, because all the students from PCOS were there, all the students from pregnancy yoga workshop were there. Yeah, so they have really got a very good insight about this and a supportive this from the Ayurveda perspective.
Yeah, and I'll request all your students to just make aware all your clients about the menstrual health, about the pregnancy health. Like, females should take care of themselves on all phases of their life.
Yeah. Really, it was it's much appreciated. Like, you have covered so many things, even the psychological aspect, which we also talk about when the prenatal and the postnatal period.
This is on rise, actually. Antenatal depression was not there a few years back, but now patients tell, like, they say that we are having this problem. Like, this
very us. True, very true.
And in fact, it's not just about the mother. Her psychological aspect, her health, that will affect the fetal health also.
Right, right. Yeah, and so, this was a very good point what you mentioned, that, you know, the diseases which occur in the middle life, mid of the life, are also, and the seeds are sown during the Garbhini period, you know, in the fetal period.
Yeah.
So that is very important. Yeah, like, how important it is.
Yes. And what is of concern is then as soon as pregnancy occurs, a whole lot of medicines are given so that pregnancy stays. I mean, like, abortion does not occur. So just with this, embryo has just started, life has just started, and it is bombarded with so much of hormones and medicines. So that affects their growth and health of the fetus also.
So we have, for this, you know, for this purpose, we are really promoting the pregnancy yoga. And we are providing the yoga lessons for pregnant women. And also we are training yoga teachers for this purpose.
Yeah.
Arjun, okay. Khushbu, there is one more question, I think.
No, ma'am. All have thanked Dr. Baljot, ma'am, for wonderful session.
So, great session. Thank you, Dr. Baljot. It was a pleasure having you and very informative. I hope everyone has gained a lot of knowledge out of this session.
Yeah, I also enjoyed.
And you could also connect with the Sanskrit words, because I know how difficult it is to, when we study the whole subject in Sanskrit and then to translate in English, and finding those words to, you know, convey to the paper is really difficult.
Yeah.
And many times, you know, in English, you don't find the synonym at all. I mean,
right. That does not convey that meaning and that essence.
Yeah, the complete meaning is not conveyed in English. Thank you so much on behalf of Pran Yoga Therapy Center. I thank all the audience, very patient audience. And Dr. Baljot has answered patiently all the questions. And in spite of the technical glitch, everyone stayed back. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for patient listening. And I just hope it has helped everyone. And
And thank you, Dr. Khushbu, for the technical assistance. You were always there with us. So.
Thank you, ma'am. Always
thank
there.
You.
I love you so much, ma'am.
Okay, we'll just wind up with the final prayers. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Thank you very much. Have a good day. Bye.
Thank